You've probably heard that throwing a penny off the Empire State Building could kill someone below. And if you've watched Mythbusters or a few other videos on YouTube, spoiler, you already know that it isn't true. But what if we change some factors of this problem? Could we get the falling penny to become more dangerous, even lethal? For example, what if our penny was denser? What if the penny fell on its edge instead of tumbling? What if it was falling in a vacuum? And if a penny won't kill you, what objects could kill you if thrown off the Empire State Building? So let's do some math, see what we can come up with. Welcome back to Math the World. In this video, we'll be using some modelings we've developed in a previous video on the penny problem. So if you want more details on those, you can check them out on the links in the description. In order to determine if a penny could kill someone, we calculated its average and peak impact force and compared it to the impact force of some situations where we know people have died from blunt objects hitting them in the head. We explored both a boxing scenario and a baseball scenario and determined that around 3,700 to 5,500 newtons is needed for a fatality. Our penny, on the other hand, only generated about 74 newtons at its peak, only enough to really feel like a flick to the head. But what if our penny had more mass? What would its mass have to become lethal? This is a pretty simple exploration. We can take our formula for impact force that we used before. We need mass, velocity, and contact time. The velocity and contact time will stay the same, and we can replace our mass with a variable, say x, and solve for x. We can see this visually in this graph as the intersection of our impact force graph with the line 3700. We see that if our penny had a mass of 0.252 kilograms, or about half a pound, it could become lethal, generating 3,700 newtons of average impact force. That's quite a lot more mass, though, 100 times more, actually. Unfortunately, there's no material found on Earth that we could make our penny out of to achieve that mass without changing its size as well. We'd need a material 100 times more dense than zinc, the main element pennies are made of nowadays, but the densest element on Earth is osmium, which is only 3 times more dense than zinc. But a low-mass black hole, like GRO J171924, would do it. Its density is estimated around 735 grams per centimeter cubed. But there might be a lot more to worry about than blunt force impact if a penny-sized black hole was coming at you. What if instead of changing mass, we could change velocity? Our tumbling penny generated 74 newtons of peak impact force. How much force would the penny generate if it didn't tumble while it fell? What if it fell on its edge all the way down? Having the penny fall on its edge will change our penny's velocity, but the mass and contact time will stay the same. We used this equation to calculate the penny's terminal velocity. We needed mass, gravity, air density, cross-sectional area, and drag coefficient. For this new scenario, everything will be the same except cross-sectional area and drag coefficient since we're changing the orientation of the falling penny. We found both the area of the penny's face and edge and averaged them to estimate the cross-sectional area as the penny tumbles. Let's replace this value with the area of just the edge of the penny to see what we get. We also used the drag coefficient of a flat circular disk, but this new shape would be a thin vertical cylinder. It was challenging finding existing data on what this drag coefficient would be, but by extending this existing model using a line of best fit, we'll estimate the drag coefficient as 0.4. Plugging these in with all our other values gets us a terminal velocity of about 71 meters per second, which is about 158 miles per hour. Pretty fast, actually. Now we can plug that into our impact force equation, and we can get 177.5 newtons of average impact force and a peak of 355 newtons. Neither the average nor the peak are in the range we determined was needed for death. It might leave you with a small goose egg, but not much else. So falling on its edge still isn't quite enough for death. What if our penny was falling in a vacuum? Without air resistance, it could reach even greater speeds. Without air resistance, our velocity equation becomes much simpler. Velocity is the square root of the initial velocity squared, which is zero in this case, plus 2 times gravity times displacement. Gravity is 9.8 meters per second squared, and displacement is the height of our penny that's being dropped from, so 381 meters. That gives us a velocity of 86 meters per second, which is almost 200 miles an hour. Pretty dang fast. To get the impact force, we multiply that by its mass, divide by contact time, to get 215 newtons on average, and 430 newtons at its peak. Still not enough to kill you with blunt force. Even if a person threw the penny down, so it had an initial velocity of 50 miles an hour, it would only achieve a speed of 89 meters per second and increase the average blunt force to 222.5 newtons. Still not enough to kill someone. Okay, so a penny-sized black hole would kill you if dropped from the roof of the Empire State Building. But a normal penny, falling in a vacuum, won't quite do the trick. What if we dropped it from a greater height inside our vacuum? How high would the penny need to be to kill you? And how fast would the penny need to be going? These are in essence the same question, since in a vacuum, displacement and velocity are proportional. So far, we've been using two formulas to determine lethality, impact force and velocity. We'll need to compose these two functions into one function and then solve for 3,700 newtons, the lower bound of our deadly force range. By placing our velocity equation inside our impact force equation, we get this function here. By setting it equal to 3,700 and solving for x, we get a height of over 100,000 meters. That's over 12 times higher than Mount Everest. At this distance, the penny would be traveling 1,480 meters per second, which is 3,310 miles per hour. To be honest, at this speed, there are many other considerations besides blunt impact force. In fact, our penny probably isn't even considered blunt anymore. It's essentially a bullet. You'll be dying of a lot more than blunt head force trauma. But let's be real. That scenario is never going to happen. So what objects could be lethal if thrown off the Empire State Building? We'll mathematically throw a cell phone, a mug, a baseball, a book, a tape measure, and a watermelon from the roof of the Empire State Building and see how lethal these objects are. All of these objects are relatively small and light. Given that a skydiver reaches terminal velocity in about 1,500 feet, let's assume all of these objects will reach their terminal velocity before hitting the ground, after falling just 1,250 feet from the Empire State Building roof. Let's start with the cell phone. To find impact force, we need mass, velocity, and contact time. The new iPhone 15 has a mass of 0.171 kilograms. It's also rather hard, so let's assume contact time is similar to our baseball from part 1, 0.001 seconds. Lastly, we'll need to find its terminal velocity. We know mass, gravity, and air density, but we need to find cross-sectional area and drag coefficient. Area will be quick. A phone will likely tumble as it falls because of the large surface area of the face. To estimate the cross-sectional area, let's find the area of the face of the phone and the small edges of the phone and do an average. Given these dimensions from the Apple website, we can quickly calculate that the average cross-sectional area is 0.00409 meters squared. Now we need a drag coefficient. Our penny falling on its face had a drag coefficient of 1.17, and falling on its edge, we estimated at 0.4. Since our phone is tumbling and has a similar thin plate shape, let's average these two and use 0.8 for our drag coefficient. This gives us a terminal velocity of about 28 meters per second, which is 62 miles per hour. A decent speed. Now we can plug that into our impact force equation, and we get 4,811 newtons on average and a peak of 9,622 newtons. This is definitely within our range of being lethal and could do some serious damage. For our other objects, we won't go into detail for all of the assumptions, but here are the values we estimated and our final calculations. For each of them, we used a similar process to the phone. We assumed the objects were tumbling and averaged cross-sectional areas of the objects as well as averaging drag coefficients. As you can see, most of these are quite lethal, all except the tape measure, though that still would not be fun to get hit in the head with. This is why hard helmets are so important at construction sites. I will also specify that the book we had in mind was a hardbound copy of the 7th Harry Potter book, taped shut so it's not flapping around while falling. This one is extremely dangerous, so please do not go throwing books off of buildings. Finally, I want to get a little more into that watermelon situation. You may be familiar with this clip from the Amazing Race TV show. And you may be wondering, how did she not die? Really, a watermelon can easily weigh 10 pounds, and that could easily have been going 30 miles an hour or more. Let's do an analysis and run some numbers. From this video footage, we can actually estimate all the things we need to find impact force. This footage was shot at 30 frames per second. I estimated that the distance from her face to the center of the catapult is about 10 feet. The watermelon covers this distance in 6 frames, which is about 0.2 seconds. This means that the watermelon's traveling about 50 feet per second, or about 15 meters per second when it collides with her face. We can also estimate the contact time duration. The watermelon appears to stay in contact for 3 frames, which would be about 0.1 seconds. Lastly, we need the mass of the watermelon. Looking at this clip here, these watermelons look smaller than average, which is what we used when we threw our watermelon mathematically off the Empire State Building. I'd guess these are about 10 inches long, so probably more like 6 kilograms in mass, or around 13 pounds. Putting this all together, we get an impact force of just 900 newtons, not within our range of death, but probably a good concussion, which is all she walked away with. This watermelon scenario actually points out a really important part of our impact force equation, contact time duration. If our watermelon behaved more like our baseball and remained in contact for only 0.001 seconds, we quickly go from 900 newtons to 90,000 newtons, a huge difference. This is why hard and soft objects make such a huge difference in these situations. Soft objects lengthen the contact time, dissipating the amount of energy being experienced over a longer amount of time and lower the average and peak impact force. This makes surviving these impacts much more likely, and this is why boxers wear gloves, gymnasts tumble on mats, batting helmets have foam pads, and cars have built-in crumple zones. So hopefully this video has shown you that throwing objects off tall buildings can have major consequences. So please, don't be an idiot. Let's keep everyone safe. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.